Welcome to the Weekly Mag. Today, we'll be talking with the award-winning and internationally acclaimed Catalan playwright, screenwriter, and director, Guillem Clua. We'll discover Look Away, Sun Child, the latest work by the folk singer-songwriter from Rupit, Matthew McDaid. And play with us with our Christmas special, guess what? Our funny, crazy TV quiz with Sergi Cervera. This is the Weekly Mag, your TV show in English, hosted by Marcella Topor.
Hello and welcome to the Weekly Mag, the TV show that helps you keep up your English. And Christmas is just around the corner and we're all in a Christmas mood, as you can see. Well, let's begin with the words and facts today with Matthew Tree's Unexpected Stories. Our reporter from Virginia, Umberto Gonzalez, hello.
Hello.
Hello. What a surprise.
I wanted to bring an enigma today, so I'm going to give you a clue. Catalan flag clause. Two words, go. Catalan flag clause. Two words, go.
Senyera clause? I don't know.
Senyera Santa.
Senyera Santa.
Senyera Santa. Good. I got you back.
Yeah, good.
You did your homework, Santa.
You know, I'm creative.
Okay, well, and of course, as always, Mario Serra's idioms. Well, let's see what these idioms are about today. So, Marius, can you give us a hint?
Yeah, my clue is that I have this lumberjack look because we are going to go to the countryside.
Wow.
Ooh. Yeah, and we talk about shepherds and grass and some other idioms. But first, we have to remember the last guess word, which was quite like Santa.
I liked it.
Let's remember the clue. It's easy, but if you know it, don't tell now, okay? It was fighting all day after Christmas in Great Britain. It was six-letter words, and you have until the end of this words and facts section to
this
know
one's easy.
It.
Yeah. Easy, but we won't say a word. Yeah. Well, as for Umberto, he's been out onto the streets to find out what embarrasses Catalans. Wow, I'm really curious to find out.
Well, I was curious too, because generally Catalans are a little bit more reserved than Americans, and I wanted to strike and see what I could get from them, but they surprised me. There were some things that they were not embarrassed about that us Americans get embarrassed about. Take a sneak peek.
Okay.
And you've said something that you said, oh my God, I shouldn't have said that.
I've done that. Guilty. Criticizing something, somebody else. A person came into the room. It was not the girl, but it was a relative.
I would be on the floor trying to like dig a hole.
Yes.
Has anybody in your family ever embarrassed you?
And they say, oh yeah, tonight like he peed in his bed. And
you know your parents kiss?
Yes.
It's disgusting, isn't it? See, for example, that. I mean, us Americans, we don't want to see our parents kiss. I mean, to us, that's almost like incest. So,
oh my God.
So, I mean, they surprised me.
When your own parents kiss?
Yes, I mean, we don't want to see that. Do you guys?
Between them?
Yes.
Well, in this video, you didn't seem too embarrassed, so I don't buy that.
No, but you're going to wait until later on. You're going to
see
some embarrassing moments that they will bring up, including one of them who made me feel very embarrassed.
But you were dressed in very great elegance.
Exactly. You were smart.
You know, I'm always elegant.
Okay, anyway, Umberto, you've certainly got our attention. We'll discover all those details about how Catalans get embarrassed later, in due time, a bit later, but now every country has different Christmas traditions, and perhaps none are as unusual as the ones in Catalonia. But does the rest of the world really, really know about them? Well, this is Matthew Tree bringing more unexpected international Catalan connections. So let's see which ones are we going to talk about today.
Yeah, well, in fact, there's a big variety of really weird Christmas traditions in Catalonia, so much so that when I discovered them and wrote back to my family, they thought I was making it all up. They thought it was completely invented. But probably one of the weirdest is the figure of what is known in English as the crapper, al caganer. Yeah. And the crapper is a little man who is, you know, doing his business, defecating within spitting distance of the Son of God in the nativity crib.
Okay. Right? So I don't blame your family.
That's right. I mean, he's there, you know, and it's all quite open and you can see everything. He first appeared in the 17th century in the Catalan nativity cribs, but the rest of the world didn't know about him until the late 20th century. And it was actually, it was thanks to me, because I was the first person who got the crapper on British television, personally.
Oh, you're the culprit.
I'm the culprit.
Hold your horses. Are you telling us that you are responsible for internationalizing the crapper? Is that what he's called overseas, the crapper?
Yes, because the program was called Eurotrash. It was presented by Jean-Paul Gaultier in English.
Wow.
And it was a program that looked for kind of weird traditions or weird people or weird situations all over Europe. And one of my jobs at the time, this is the mid-1990s, I was the fixer for Eurotrash in Catalonia. So they asked me, you know, is there anything particularly weird in Catalonia? And I just said, oh boy, if only you knew. And so I explained the whole business about the crapper. They sent a TV crew down and I organized the shoots and everything. And they did a whole program about the Catalan Christmas, the crapper, the making a piece of wood defecate as well. I mean, the whole thing is like quite scatological. And that appeared in 1994 on Eurotrash in the month of November, and it was seen by 3 million people.
Wow.
In the UK.
Wow.
And that was the very first time the crapper was actually shown outside of Catalonia.
Wow. So was there a second time?
There was, but much later. This was 2004. Okay. 2009, Stephen Fry, the actor and writer, had a program, a sort of quiz program, bit like your quiz program, in fact, called QI. And it was a true or false type of question. And one of the questions that he asked was, is it true that in Catalonia, they have a person who's, I think he used he used the word that you explained so well the other day, who's
a four-letter word,
shitting inside the crib. And most people couldn't believe that
they were shocked.
They were shocked. They could not believe that this was real until he explained that, in fact, it was. That was another thing. And
amazing.
Since then, in fact, the crapper has become an international figure. I mean, the figures themselves sold to 143 different countries.
Get out of here.
And the United States is the biggest buyer.
Get out.
Because they do American presidents. You've got Obama was very big for 4 years.
Oh my God, Trump sold out. I lived right in front of the plaza of the Catedral. And Trump sold out for like most of the season. I couldn't find a Trump crapper.
No, and he was really popular too. And the weird thing was that after COVID came along, they had Trump with a mask on. And if there's one thing I'm pretty sure about, it's that Trump does not go to the toilet with a mask on. In fact, he doesn't do anything with a mask on, but specifically that, you know.
Okay, well, Matthew, I suppose not everything that has to do with Christmas is scatological.
No,
right?
Food. Food is very important, but food, of course. Yeah, okay, I'll just get off the scatological thing. there's one of the most popular desserts in Christmas desserts in Catalonia is the turró. It's actually quite difficult to explain it, but I usually explain it to English-speaking people by saying it's a nougat bar, it's something like that. Traditionally, in fact, they come from Shishona in Valencia, the Valencian area, but they're also made in Catalonia, especially in the town of Agramunt, where they actually have a factory in the shape of an Agramunt turró. Which I saw not so long ago. The typical ones are basically chocolate made out of chocolate and almonds. And those are the ones that get exported. And the amazing figure is that one out of every five turrons made either in Catalonia or Valencia go abroad, get exported. And again, It's you guys again. It's the United States.
I know. Turan is huge in the United States.
But funnily enough, they're also very big in Poland and Sweden for some reason. And Israel spends 2 million euros every year on Turans.
Wow!
It's the only non-European country which really likes the Turans.
Now, Marcella said there were going to be three things. Is the third one going to be the cagatillo, and is he called the Uncle Crapper?
Yeah. In the program that we did for Eurotrash, we called it the Crapping Log.
The
Crapping Log. Because we wanted to avoid the four-letter word shit, basically, okay. Which is too strong in English. Yeah. We've had this conversation, but not in the States, you know. It's like... So I thought the third tradition is the one that takes place on Boxing Day, which here is called St. Stephen's Day. It's traditional to have a big lunch on St. Stephen's Day as well as on Christmas Day. And the typical food is cannelloni, which is not actually Catalan.
That's Italian.
Yeah, exactly.
At all.
Absolutely.
It's Italian. And it was imported by Italian chefs in the late 18th century when the first sort of eating houses, you wouldn't call them restaurants, started to appear in Catalonia. And it was Italian chefs who introduced cannelloni to the Catalan diet, because before that, on Boxing Day or St. Stephen's Day, what Catalans had done with their leftovers from Christmas Day was just put them in a bowl of rice, you know, and sort of eat it all up. Right. Whereas the Catalan bourgeoisie thought it was much nicer to have it all wrapped up in a little roll of pasta. And of course, they're covered in bechamel sauce, which is French, so you've got this Franco-Italian speciality, which has now become a Catalan Christmas tradition.
A very elegant way to get rid of your leftovers.
Exactly, you can't even see them because they're in that little roll.
And the bechamel, which is really good, no? One of the greatest French inventions.
So there you go, that's three Catalan Christmas traditions.
Well, so we have, Caganés, Turrons, Cannelloni.
Not in that order.
Exactly, not in that order. So you've really put us in the mood for the upcoming days, Matthew.
I hope so.
Now let's get into the ins and outs of some English idioms with Marius. Let's see what we have prepared for you.
An idiom that I love is red sky at night, shepherd's delight. I say it all the time when you come from somewhere like the UK. I mean, I grew up in London. When you see red sky at night, it's like, oh great, it's going to be good weather tomorrow. And that's quite unusual. So it's something that I think it's very poetic, and it's something that you always enjoy seeing.
So did you wake up on the wrong side of the bed? I use this a lot with my kids because sometimes they do wake up a little cranky. And the expression is used when people wake up a little off. They're not their typical self. So they woke up on the wrong side of the bed. There you go. That's why I use this a lot, especially with my kids and my husband.
The expression I like it is the grass of the neighbor is always greener, because I think it's what we do as people. Most of the times, like, we think like others' life is always better. And when you get inside the other's life, you realize that you are not as bad as you thought. I mean, it's like a life lesson. When you get it, you are much happier than before, you know?
Nice ones.
Yeah, some weather idioms, it's quite usual. But this one, this special one, red sky at night, shepherd's delight, has an opposite, which is red sky in the morning, shepherd's warning. So that you have for good or bad weather. In fact, originally it appeared in the New Testament, but with a variation, not related to shepherds, but to sailors. I don't know if you use them or you know them, but that one was red sky at night, sailors' delight. Because they were sailing, right?
Never heard that one.
You are not with New Testament, I see you.
We're too young for that.
thank you, Umberto.
In fact, the gospel, what the gospel says exactly is, when it is evening, yes, say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be full weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. So from that idea, which maybe we've got in Catalan some weather idioms like cel rugent, pluja o vent, which means red sky, it will be, or a rainy day, or a windy day, right? Mm. Well, this is popular, then you've got science with all the meteo men just making things more detailed. But this is sort of usual weather idioms. I don't know if you know any weather idiom or any expression related to weather?
It took me by storm. It took me by surprise. It took me by storm.
By storm, yeah. Right.
Do you guys use that too?
Yeah.
Well, certainly there is no end to weather-related idioms, but today we've heard one which is very similar to the one you explained last week, Marius.
Yeah, this is quite interesting because last week we just did to be born on the wrong side of the blanket. It meant it was an euphemism for being a bastard, for being born out of wedlock, right? But this one is entirely different. She said to wake up on the wrong side of the bed.
Yeah, that one I've heard.
And that means wake up cranky. That's cranky. More usual. Do you know that?
Yeah.
It's usual. The question is, which is the wrong side of the bed? Right, Hans?
Oh, I never thought about that.
It depends on the person.
I think it would
exactly.
be...
Exactly.
For you?
Well, I always sleep on the left. I always get out on the left, and I always feel lousy in the morning. So, yeah, probably the...
The wrong side is the left.
Left-hand
right?
side, yeah.
Well, it's normally this. Instead, if you maybe sleep with a wall on your left, right? Because then you can't get up. But it comes from Latin, because the left side in Latin was sinister, which meant left. And now it means the wrong way of life. A sinister is a negative word, right? And idioms with the same idea came from Julius Caesar and could be left foot forward or get off on the wrong foot, which is always the left. This is a superstitious belief that maybe it's unlucky to put your left foot first in place or to walk into a house with a left foot. The Romans and Augustus Caesar were very careful that they got up on the right side of the bed, and they wrote that. So I have a positive refrain involving a bed, and would be another one, which I'm sure you will, all of you will be with me.
It didn't help Julius.
With
he
me
still
and with
got
Julius,
up on the wrong side of the bed.
Early to bed and early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise.
That's bullshit.
That's also
just not true.
Don't you?
Well. No. No. Absolutely not.
Well, no. Times have changed.
Yes.
Well, no. Matthew is not with Julius.
I feel healthier and wiser if I get up about 11 o'clock. You know, it's just,
in the morning.
In the morning, yeah.
How long did you do that?
Wealthier, no.
Okay, and third and last, the grass of the neighbor is always greener. Well, it has a very clear meaning, I think.
It's related to envy, absolutely. It's quite clear, transparent one. Curiously enough, green is the color of envy because you can be green with envy, right? It's the color of hope as well. But you are green with envy because you
it's
look
on the left side
of your bed.
And I have to say, I wouldn't like to correct the person you interviewed, but the phrase I've always heard is the grass is always greener on the other side
of the fence. But Mike. Yeah, I had to do that, but I would make you a question.
Or on the other side directly.
Or on the other side, yeah.
Who is on the other side of your fence?
Your neighbor.
Your neighbor.
Yeah.
That's it. That's a link. But maybe in America
it's a variation,
the fence,
right?
Well, no, we don't say the fence. We just say the grass is always greener on the other side and leave it
just
at that.
Mm. Okay.
We don't like fences.
Okay. There are more idioms about grass, and not talking about marijuana, just grass, which is don't want to cut someone else's grass. Do you know
that? I never heard of that one.
Well, it's quite delicate. Maybe you have a boyfriend and another one comes.
Are you looking at me?
I'm looking at you. And maybe I come there and just I like your boyfriend. And maybe you tell me, I don't want to cut my grass.
Okay.
That's the idea.
Oh.
Having this analogy
it's
to a
like
garden.
It's like a capital sin or something.
A
right?
capital sin, that's it. Ooh. So it's a question of jealousy in this case, not of envy, but of jealousy. And the other one is very ironic, and that's my favorite. This is as exciting as watching grass grow.
I never heard of that one either.
No, the one I've always heard for that, it's about as interesting as watching paint dry. Which I
nice
think is
one.
Even more boring than
more
watching
boring.
Grass grow.
Yeah. It's quicker.
Very nice.
Yeah. Maybe it's more boring but quicker because grass grows very, very, very slowly.
Yeah, but at least it's alive.
Yeah, absolutely.
And now it's time to watch Umberto's video about embarrassing situations which he shot in Alella. So Umberto, why did you choose this particular town?
Alella just happens to be a really nice, quaint village near the sea, close to the mountains, and very close to the metropolitan area of Barcelona. And I thought, let's go hit it over there. And it just goes to show from the people that I interviewed how interesting it is that even in this idyllic place, you get a lot of the similar social embarrassments that you get in other places. Take a look. If only I could tell you what embarrasses Americans, ladies and gentlemen, but then I'd be censored. And I was thinking, I wonder what embarrasses the Catalans. So let's find out in Alella. What embarrasses you?
This interview, I would say.
Tinder dates, the first minute maybe, and then the ice is broken.
Marius, did you hear that? The ice is broken.
No. And then, yes. I get embarrassed when I can't remember words in Catalan when I'm speaking to people.
Suddenly I had a laugh attack in a waiting room in the hospital.
I'd say, you know this kind of dream where you wake up and you're naked and nobody is? So that would be it.
That would embarrass you.
Suddenly I'm naked.
Have you ever stripped your pants?
Yeah.
Has it been in front of a Tinder date?
No, not Tinder date.
In a disco, I stuck to the wall until I left.
Oops! Have you ever passed gas in front of a group?
Oh God, yes, I have. I was walking across the beach. A group of men applauded me. It was highly embarrassing.
It wasn't a loud one.
It must have been.
The elevator one. I was alone and I was going down and then at the next floor, a woman came in and was like, of course she knew it was me.
Yeah, in glass.
They know it was
no,
you?
No, I was doing that. Oof, oof, oof.
Have you ever peed in public and have you ever been embarrassed because somebody saw you?
Yes, police. 300 euros.
300 euros?
Yes.
Does that mean?
Just to make pee-pee.
I'm embarrassed now. I'm turning red. Have you ever said a word that you meant to say another one, but they're false friends and you say something else?
Sticca lenta.
Oh!
Yeah.
And you meant you were hot.
There's false friend. They make you laugh, for instance, this is the typical one, I'm constipated. Oh, sorry, teacher, I couldn't come, I was constipated. And what they meant, as you may know, they had a cold.
Embarrassed? Yeah. Embarazado?
Focus.
Perfect!
Yeah, now I learn.
Yeah. Can you pronounce it wrongly for us, just for a second?
Focus.
I don't know if we can put that on TV, Danny. Have you ever went up to somebody and said hi, thinking that you knew them, but you didn't know them?
And many times. Kiss him, hello, and he say, well, no, I was saying hello to another one.
Can I ask you to go up to one person over there and say, hi, Joe, and see if they answer? Joe could be anybody.
Hello, how are you?
I'm here.
I don't see any embarrassment here, ladies and gentlemen. Nuria! Nuria!
No.
You're not Nuria. Are you Nuria?
I am Nuria.
Conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, I tried to break the Catalan state to give me all their embarrassing moments, and they held strong. Yeah, they actually got less embarrassed than I thought.
They were quite open, actually, yeah, exactly. About explaining.
Yes. Nice. So anyway, what do you guys think was the worst thing to be embarrassed about?
From the video?
Yes.
I would have been extremely embarrassed if I'd been walking across the beach, farted loudly, and a group of women started applauding me. That, which yeah. The reverse situation of that
you.
Lady.
I'm with you.
Yeah. I really.
Yeah, probably that one. You know.
But it's quite interesting that girl that told you embarrassed, embarazada,
yes.
Like yeah. Pregnancy, right? Because this false friend sometimes.
Well,
yeah. And the one about conception.
Constipated.
Constipated.
Right. Yeah, that's the same.
Constipated. Yeah, that one's actually. Yeah. It was. I had never heard that one before.
I actually found myself in both situations when I years ago when I started to learn Catalan. So I made those mistakes too. And
but in fact, people were laughing at me. Constipació, in fact, in Catalan, it used to mean the same than in English, but it evolved.
Really?
Yeah, oh. And maybe from a medical point of view, it's still. Working this meaning of that word, but not popular.
Anyway, Umberto, you must tell us about the situation where you found yourself really embarrassed.
Oh,
you said it was something incredible, but I'm not sure if I believe you.
I thought I was trying to divert the conversation away from that. That was doing really good. But
I think all of us are really curious to find out.
Okay, so something happened. I was just being little old me, and we were walking. Danny and I were walking. We saw this huge box, and I said, Danny, it's so huge. I want to get into that box and be like a cat and come out and sing. And Danny goes, go ahead, do it. I'll film it. So he started filming it, and it was in front of a woman's house. And see what happened. I was embarrassed.
The things I do for love, the things I do for love, like walking down the rain and the snow, and there's nowhere to go when it lights.
I'm sorry. You don't hit the box now, no?
Yeah, we were playing.
Wait, is the baby sleeping?
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Embarrassing. Embarrassing. Yeah, I mean, like, when we finished filming, I said, did you catch all that? I mean, because that was live. I mean, that was actual, like.
That was really funny, actually.
Yeah, but I was embarrassed because she came out all of a sudden out of the door. But you know, something came out good out of it. I interviewed her. She was the one that spoke about the.
Yeah, exactly.
Contraceptive. Oh, and was it contraceptive? Or, I can't remember what it was. So anyway, and her baby was not awoken or anything else. She brought the laptop outside and she had the laptop looking at her baby while she was being interviewed. Everything went well.
Okay, it's good to know that she wasn't mad at you or anything.
No. I don't know how.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, how could anyone get mad at you?
Ooh,
it's impossible,
I've seen it
almost.
I've seen it happen.
Now let's go to Guess Word, because Mario Serra is keeping a special Guess Word for the Christmas season. So we are really looking forward to it.
Yeah, I hope to keep all of our couch, dear, couch potatoes. Do you remember that expression?
Yeah, exactly.
Very entertained all this Christmas time. But you are so quick that before we have to solve our last Guess Word, right? Mm-hmm. So it was also related to Christmas, and I think all of you knew that it was fighting all day after Christmas in Great Britain. Do you know that? I think you mentioned even
you mentioned talking
about cannelloni. Yeah. So the answer was
Boxing Day.
Our exactly. San Stephen, our Boxing Day.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the States, what's it called?
In the States?
The day after Christmas.
We don't have it.
You don't have it.
We're boring. We don't have a day. I mean, we don't have a name for it. It's December 26th.
You don't do anything special?
We go to everybody's houses. So the 26th is when the 25th you usually spend with your family. You may visit some people, but on the 26th you visit other people's homes. You give them their gifts. It's all about gifts, remember?
About gifts again.
Okay. Anyway, yeah, that was just the warm-up for our special Christmas Guess What. So bring it on, Marius.
Yeah.
I know this is different.
This is quite different. It will be a quadruple Guess What. And I hope I will keep you entertained a little bit for all these days. It's about finding four Christmas carols. So you, Umberto, will love it as yeah. you have, and you don't.
No, I won't.
But for our all our viewers, I'll give you four easy guess words for you to guess four keywords, just keywords, and each one makes you go to a Christmas carol. So, mind you, I'm not hiding the whole title, just one word, right? But this keyword, absolutely easy to go to the Christmas carol. For instance, the first one, the first clue will be desire, four letters. Desire, four letters. From desire, you get a word, maybe a synonym, and from that word, you get a Christmas carol for sure.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Right, I get it.
Second one, Californian Monica. This is five letters word. Californian Monica, five letters. Again, it's just one word, but with this five letter word, no doubt you will know which is our Christmas carol we are searching. The third one, speechless, six letters. Speechless, six letters. From that, this is, I think, the easiest. Even you
Even
will
I
know, Matthew.
It, yeah.
And the last one will be gongs. Five letters. Gongs. Five
gongs,
letters.
Like you gong somebody?
That's it.
Okay.
That's it.
The second one is pretty easy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the guess words are quite easy, but then you have to make the second pass going to the Christmas song. And if you like, you can sing it.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, that's Santa Mario Serra with an early Christmas present for puzzle lovers. You can already try and crack these special Christmas guess words. And just remember, you have to guess not only the word, but the whole Christmas carol title. So the solutions on our profiles in the following weeks. Until then, well, Matthew, Marius, Umberto, I can only say a Merry Christmas, have a great holiday and a Happy New Year, and I'll see you soon.
You too.
Señora Santa.
The same to you. And don't forget, Señora Santa is watching you.
Okay, I hope you'll bring us many presents.
Or coal.
Okay, and since we are in the mood for Christmas, we'd like to recommend the classic for these days, A Christmas Carol, a story well worth watching or reading more than once, and our experts will tell you why. Over to Salvador Faura from the Xarxa, the Bibliotecas Municipals of the Diputació de Barcelona, and Miquel López from Televisió de Badalona.
A Christmas Carol is the English-speaking equivalent of the Catalan Els Pastorets. And I say that because I think there is no city large or small, no town large or small, no hamlet whatsoever in Britain or America where there isn't a theatre where a Christmas Carol is not played Yuletide after Yuletide. The story of the book is about three spirits who come and visit a particular man. The name of the first of these spirits is called the spirit of Christmas present. Then we have the spirit of Christmas past. And the third is the spirit of Christmas yet to come. The objective of the book is that after their visit, this man, Scrooge, becomes a better person. I think you become a better person too after reading this book, shall we?
Charles Dickens novels have been adapted lots of times for the cinema. We have seen different versions of Oliver Twist, David Copperfield, Great Expectations, and of course, A Christmas Carol, a must in cinemas and televisions around the world at Christmas time. Let me recommend you a 1984 version that is very faithful to the spirit of Dickens' novel. British director Clive Donner directed this movie with a brilliant British cast, with one exception. The starring role was played by American actor George C. Scott. In the role of Mr. Scrooge, George C. Scott is on occasion very rude and at other times very human and sensitive. So have a very merry Christmas with this movie, but please be careful not to get any visit from the ghosts of Christmas past, present, and yet to come. Merry Christmas.
Who said second parts were never good? Stay tuned for a chat with the Catalan playwright Guillem Clua about the sequel of his internationally acclaimed play, Smiley.
Time for today's portrait. So what has a former motocross world champion ended up doing on the Costa Brava? Well, let's meet Pedro Tractor, a Dutch motocross rider who has fulfilled his dream of living in the sunny and quiet Ampurria Brava.
My name is Pedro Tractor. I'm a professional motocross rider. I'm born in Holland, the Netherlands. Since 2012, I live in Catalonia, Spain. When I was young, 5-6 years old, I came here on holiday with my family. That was the first time. And always my father say, when I pass Ampurria Brava, they say, we have to go over here. But that time, I know it was 45 years ago, I think, so it was nothing there. So we went to, every time we go to Roses. And now I live here, so it was my dream to live in Spain, Catalonia. I'm a riding world champion. I was 24 years old. I got world champion on the Suzuki 125 bikes. I was world champion one time in 1993. Before I was four time, third. So one time world champion, and that's the goal I want to beat. Of course, we got the motocross tracks here in this neighborhood, but not so many. It's not the best place to live for motocross because the tracks are far away from here. And the big ones are more in the south or in the middle of Spain. In the beginning, I was teaching lessons in Holland too. And I came here to Spain. I was teaching some riders over here also. And my decision also to come here to Spain was the business for enduro groups riding. But that was not good. So I stopped with this. And now I'm working with Import Cross, the biggest Suzuki dealer of Spain. We got a team also here in Spain together with Import Cross. And I was teaching these riders and coaching, and well, we get not world champion, but they are improvements and they're going better and better. Well, what you have to say to young riders is take the phone away. It's very important because they are all the day looking in the telephone, Instagram or Facebook or something like that. No, they have to concentrate what they have doing for training and riding. They have to listen to the coach. That's more important. The best way for practicing is you have to go every day with the bike, but you have to do something every day for the condition. I think for everybody, for every sport, what kind of sport you do, it's all the same for everybody. My feeling is, when you're on a bike, I like it so much, and it's for freedom, it's for freedom.
Our next guest began his career as a journalist, but he decided to change reality for the freedom of fiction. He was recently chosen by the Ministerio de Cultura y Deporte as the Premio Nacional de Literatura Dramática of 2020 for the play Justicia. We are pleased to share some time on the show today with Guillem Clua. Guillem, a pleasure to have you here today. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Well, first of all, congratulations on the prize for the work Justicia. This is a Spanish prize for a play written and released in Catalan. right? So it's something quite unusual. You were at the TNC, Teatre Nacional de Catalunya, with José María Pou. It was a great success, but then you had to stop because of the pandemic, COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So the award lasted more or less for a month, you could say?
No, the award, I got the award recently, and it came up as a big surprise because, as you said, it was a shock for us to have to cancel the performances. Everything stopped, and it was very sad for us because we only had 3 or 4 weeks run in, and I thought that was it, that I would never hear about Justicia or anything else after that. And then this big award was a great surprise.
What can you tell us about Justicia, the play?
Justicia tells the story of a family, a Catalan family, for 80 years, from the end of the Civil War until the present. And it follows the life of Samuel Gallard, a judge and a politician, who has a hidden personality. He's gay, he's been in the closet for all his life, and all the decisions he makes about his love life, about his politic decisions, and everything else is destroying his whole family and everything that surrounds it.
Mm-hmm. So it's a deep play, a controversial subject with political connotations.
Yeah, it was. I had the feeling that I had to write something political about Catalan identity and about recent history in order to understand who we are from the stage of the National Theatre. I think a public theatre has this duty to tell the story of its country from the voice of their playwrights, and I took that challenge, and it was great to have the opportunity to write it. Mm-hmm.
It was a good idea also, because you had your reward.
Yes.
Afterwards. Okay, there is an anecdote saying that the Minister of Culture, José Manuel Rodríguez Uribet, called you to let you know of the decision.
Yeah, that came.
Is that right?
It was a shock for me. I was in an interview like this one, and my phone started ringing, and I didn't know who it was. Of course, I couldn't answer. And when the interview was over, I had tens of messages from WhatsApp and emails asking me I should call the Ministry of Culture. Of course I called. I thought it was a joke, but it wasn't. Oh. So I was very happy.
Let's leave Justicia aside to talk about Smiley. You did something quite unusual in the theatre world, which is you created a second part for a very successful play for Smiley. Smiley, després de l'amor. Did you know at the beginning you are going to write the second part of the play, given also the fact that it's not something very common in theatre to do that?
No, it's quite unprecedented. I don't think that anybody has done this before here in Catalonia. But I didn't know I was going to write a sequel to Smiley 8 years ago when it first premiered. Of course, Smiley was one of my most successful plays. It's been translated into several languages. It's been put on stage everywhere in the world. And I was asked to do it again, to make a revival here in Barcelona some years ago. And I thought it would be a good idea. I read the play and I saw that it still worked as a comedy. But the themes, the characters, all of us, the actors, the original actors and myself, had grown up when we are 40-something, and I felt that it was not honest to tell the same story of 30-something gay men looking for love in Barcelona, but to think about what it means to be a gay man in Barcelona when you are over 40 and with the influence of new apps and technologies that have changed our relationships. Mm-hmm. It's still a comedy, it's still a romantic comedy, let's not forget that. And I guess one of the keys to its success is that it's so lively and fresh and funny, and people laugh all the time. But there's no light without shadows, and this second part, it has more shadows, more mature themes that I wanted to explore. And I think it's been also very successful. We still hadn't had a long run yet, but it feels like it will be a great success as well.
Well, like you said, Alex and Bruno, after 8 years, have changed. So how have they actually evolved as characters?
It's when you're 30 or when you're younger, maybe you can make decisions that don't feel so definitive. You have the luxury of failing, and you can fall and you will get up again. But after 40, when you're reaching 50, it's in the horizon, especially in love themes, that you don't have the luxury anymore. Your decisions have to be final, or at least they feel like they are. And you grow up into a more serious place and regarding the mistakes you made in the past. So there's the presence of some ghosts in the play, literally they appear, and they challenge the characters, making them face the decisions they made in the past and how they are going to be in the future, or about their happiness. What does being happy mean, or being with someone, or being in love? And those are questions that in the original play, which was a classic romantic comedy, they didn't ask themselves. It was just, you know, the traditional structure of a romantic comedy of two people looking for love. Now it's different.
Is the play autobiographical, and what was the source of inspiration
it is
for
quite,
Smiley?
Yeah, it's quite autobiographical. All of my plays have something of from my personal life, of course. It wouldn't be honest to say otherwise. But this one in particular, it's about the gay life in Barcelona and about how gay men fall in love and how they understand love. And I, as a gay man, have a deep connection with that, and I have the information firsthand, so to speak. So, yeah, people can recognize a lot of Guillem Clua in both Smileys.
Okay, if we haven't seen the first play, and we would like to see Smiley, Después del Amor, will we understand the play completely, or is it necessary to see the first one?
No, it's not necessary, because actually you don't have the opportunity to see the first one. So I wrote the play so you could see it independently. I was very afraid to do that, of course, because you cannot catch a DVD and watch the first part, and people maybe would be hesitant to go to the theater if they hadn't seen part one. But everybody who sees Smiley, Després del Amor says that they understand it perfectly. There are some flashbacks in it as well,
okay,
in order to remind people.
Which help.
Yes, they help a lot, and they put you in the situation, and they understand everything. So yeah, you can go to the theater and watch it, no problem.
Well, talking about play, which is quite a phenomenon. It's not so common for a play to have such a great success. Not just in its own country, but abroad, because, like you said, it has been performed in so many languages, and I would say even that it is a true phenomenon. Actually, I know that, correct me if I'm wrong, Smiley, the first part, will be premiered this year in Australia, mm-hmm, and Singapore, and I would like to ask you, how has it been received in different countries, in different cultures, and if you have any anecdotes about people's reactions, the audience reactions in different countries.
The amazing thing about Smiley is that in the surface it's a harmless rom-com about two people falling in love, and maybe in Western countries it was just that, and people saw it and they had a great time and they recommended it, and that was it, and it was a success. But suddenly, when it was put on stage in countries where gay rights are not respected, or where they are still fighting to normalize LGBTQ rights, that harmless comedy became a political weapon.
Of course.
Yes, and in countries in South America or in Eastern Europe or even Singapore, for example, where gay rights are challenged and they deny the existence of LGBTQ people, mm-hmm, I found out that it was so important to have this tool, so harmless in appearance, but so powerful in context. So we had situations where they tried to ban it from festivals in Chile, for example, or there was a big controversy in Italy, in Naples, I think it was, because the play was staged in a former church, and that was, people got very angry with that. But overall, I think it's doing so much good, not only because you have fun, because it normalizes it, it makes visible other kinds of love and other ways of being that I hope it will be on stage in different countries in the world in the next year, especially because now they are all of them are asking for the sequel.
Exactly. Well, Guillem, you are very active on social media, on Instagram, on Twitter. You have lots of followers, and you've been very critical with many things. You've been critical towards the politicians' actions about the pandemic, and also their the effect all this had on the cultural sector, which affects you, of course, and actors and so many artists. So. What would you say about the current situation of theatre in the country in this moment?
Mm-hmm. Well, theatre or all the culture has never been a priority for our politicians. It doesn't matter what from what political party or from what administration. I think they are not doing a great job protecting culture. In meetings and everywhere, when they have their speeches, they talk about how important our culture is. But when it comes to facts, when they have to protect it, especially in this crisis and in other crises we had before, we realize that they are not up to their duties because we don't get enough support, we don't get enough money to survive. There are people who are lining up in food banks because they don't have anything to eat, professionals, dancers, actors, technicians. And the few money that they give to companies or theaters is not enough. And I know that this situation is unprecedented and it's so difficult to manage, but we only ask that there's a unique, clear message, measures that we can be comfortable with and that they don't destroy the industry. And right now this is not happening.
All right, well, we'll continue our chat with Guillem Clua precisely about activism and how theatre can help change society for the better. Before continuing, let's hear today's first language tip. Our teacher, Mark Broderick, is going to discover some English words related to Catalan and Occitan.
Hello, so I have a couple of words which are delicious and a couple of words which are not so delicious and that come from Catalan and, curiously enough, Occitan. Now, many English speakers don't even know what Occitan is, I imagine, but some of the words that derive from this language they will definitely be familiar with. And the first ones are alioli and paella, which of course come from a very medieval version of Catalan, Occitan, or French. Then we have a couple of more delicious words, cucumber and aubergine, and a not so delicious one, which is a squirrel, although I haven't eaten it, so I cannot quite tell you whether it's delicious or not. Another one of these words that we use in English would be barracks. Now, barracks has absolutely nothing to do with barraca, all right? A barracks is in fact a building which houses soldiers, or a group of buildings which house soldiers and comes from medieval Catalan and Occitan. And did you know that the word gay comes from Occitan, gai, which of course means, you got it, merry or happy. Bias is another word, and of course, if you are biased something, you don't see anybody else's point of view, all right? You only think about your point of view and the rest of it does not matter. So you have some sort of bias towards it. Now, in Catalan, you do have an expression which is similar, which is informació esbiaixada, okay? And this literally means the same in English, that this information has been biased. And the final word we have, of course, is cava. And with that, I say cheers.
What Welcome back. We're talking with the playwright, screenwriter and director Guillem Clua, and joining us today is our contributor Barney Griffiths, who's done a bit of research about how theatre has raised awareness about gay discrimination. So we're talking to Barney. Let's welcome Barney Griffiths. So welcome, Barney, and tell us all about Smiley and your research.
Okay, hi Marcella and hi Guillem. Nice to be back.
Hi.
Well, Smiley is a play that deals with gay relationships. So let's talk a little bit about the history of gay relationships in the theatre, how plays portraying those relationships have evolved over time and passed from being what was initially a taboo subject completely to denouncing the lack of rights of the gay community, and then how they are finally now received today. Theatre has long been considered a mirror of society, and imagine looking into that mirror and not seeing yourself. And that's what lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender people have faced over the years. And they have struggled to gain representation in the theatre.
If we actually look at the history of gay activism in the theatre, several plays have been important for gay rights. Is that so?
Yeah, that's right. So perhaps the first, going back a long way, was a play by the actress Mae West in 1927. Mm-hmm. Now, as an avid supporter of gay rights throughout her life, Mae West made big waves with this play called The Drag in 1927, which she wrote under the pen name Jane Mast, interestingly, not using her own name. It was about a gay man who marries a woman to hide his sexuality. Now, The Drag caused outrage at the time for its depiction of homosexuality and cross-dressing. And in fact, it was a huge financial success, but it never made it to Broadway because it was banned due to obscenity laws.
Wow.
So here's my first question for Guillem, is that type of play a long time ago, almost 100 years ago, do any historical plays like that, have they influenced you at all?
Well, I've been influenced by older plays, of course, mostly American, but not that old. I mean, maybe the oldest play I've been influenced by are the ones by Tennessee Williams, for example, and later on, maybe from the 80s and the 90s, Tony Kushner or Terence McNally and Joe Orton, who's English, not American, but all the Anglo-Saxon gay plays who paved the way for us who came later to speak about these issues have been very important to me.
Okay, good. Well, I'm going to come to a couple of those in a minute as we make our way through. So since at least the 1950s, the theatre has actively worked to bring attention to issues in the LGBT community. But it wasn't until The Boys in the Band by Mark Crowley in 1968 that homosexuality was introduced as the central theme of the play. Now, I know you know about this play, so I'll talk to you about it in a second, Guillem, but let's first of all mention that that play made the struggle of gays much more visible and also was an empowering factor inspiring the Stonewall riots in New York, which was really a catalyst for radicalizing the gay rights movement and really a turning point for changing political policies in the United States. And this groundbreaking play premiered off-Broadway in 1968, as I said, but it ran for over 1,000 performances. And then recently, in 2018, The Boys in the Band made its Broadway debut, finally, at the Booth Theatre. Now, you mentioned to me earlier, Guillem, that actually it's also been made into a film, is that right?
Yeah, you can see it on Netflix, I think. Ryan Murphy directed it. But it's funny to see how such an important play, because it was so important and at the time to depict the life of regular gay men as the central subject of a play. Now, when you see it, you can feel that it's a little dated and it has getting a little old because it speaks from about that subject from the 60s, and the reality of LGBTQ people have changed so much, then you can see that those conflicts are not relevant anymore. It's interesting to see it as from a historical point of view or an anthropological point of view, but it doesn't speak to the audiences right now as it used to.
Right, yeah, I'm sure things have moved on quite significantly since then. But just to go back to the theme of New York, because that's where the play is set and conceived, that you lived in New York yourself, didn't you? Mm-hmm. Would you say that society is more open? I mean, it's been a few years since you lived there, but would you say it's more open to the gay community, gay activism, than Barcelona, for example?
Yeah, of course, they had. I mean, the gay struggle, the gay fight, the LGBTQ rights fight was born there in Stonewall in the late 70s. So they started the fire, and then the fire got everywhere else. And we had our first gay demonstrations here in 1977, I think. It was years after Stonewall. And it had a big influence everywhere. And of course, here we were so worried about getting out of the Franco cave and starting our own democracy that maybe gay rights or gay culture or gay plays were not as relevant as they were in New York. But we kept up doing it, and I think we still have a long way to run, but New York has been always a great influence to us.
Right. Returning to the history of gay relationships and gay activism in the theatre, throughout the 1970s, more and more theatre representing gay themes emerged. The Other Side of Silence was the first professional gay theatre company to form in 1974. And by 1979, there were over 150 professional gay theatre companies in the US. Mm-hmm. Now, I know you just said, Guillem, that's not so much the case here, but why are there any gay theatre, professional gay theatre companies here? And if not, why not, do you think?
I think that we're struggling getting out of so many crises. Mm. So in the 80s and the 90s, it was the golden age of companies here in Barcelona and Spain. And most of our most popular companies that have toured the world and are still active, like La Fura dels Baus, Comedians, and others, were born there. But then the crisis started coming, and we had the financial crisis in 2008, and then we are having this crisis now. And there's no way to evolve naturally and to have a whole diversity of companies that are specifically about one subject or about some issues that might be relevant. So companies now are being born, they struggle, they die, they transform. And I hope that when this pandemic is over and when the economic situation is solved, we can have those kind of companies in the future.
Yeah, I guess what you mentioned earlier to Marcello as well, the fact that the culture here in itself is struggling financially with help from the government doesn't help that situation. Right?
Yes, that's a problem. I mean, culture here is always sick. There's no way that it can be healthy, 100% healthy. It's always, when some problem gets solved, then another comes up, and it's terrible.
Mm-hmm. But right. If there aren't any companies here, what about Europe? Other countries in Europe?
Yeah, especially in the UK or France that I know of, there are particular companies that do LGBTQ plays, or they just tell stories about LGBTQ people. But here, not yet. We'll see.
Okay, so just to finish off our little history episode, then in 1980 there was the first mainstream lesbian piece of theatre in America, Last Summer at Bluefish Cove. Jane Chambers' work stands out simply because of the fact that it was the first time a lesbian woman was telling her own story rather than a male writer. Perhaps though, the most prominent play of that period, you've already mentioned, Guillem, is Tony Kushner's Angels in America, a gay fantasia on national themes. This is an epic two-part play, which each part lasting up to 3 hours, and it uses a mixture of realism and fantasy to examine the complicated interconnections between race, religion, politics, and sexual identity in the 1980s. As you mentioned earlier, Guillem, probably a little bit dated now compared to what we're used to, but from your own experience, how would you say things have changed for the gay community in the last 20, 30 years since those times in the 1980s? Mm.
The thing is that Angels in America is quite relevant right now. It may be the play that has influenced me most in my whole career, and Tony Kushner in particular, but that play is astonishing. I think it's one of the major plays in the 20th century. And the themes that are in Angels in America, which are religion, politics, fascism, AIDS, We are in the middle of a pandemic, and this pandemic is changing our relationship with each other. Gay relationships, discrimination, family issues, everything is in that play. And those universal themes that Tony Kushner tackles are so important right now. They're still so relevant, and they affect us not only as a gay man, but also as a society, that we still have to deal with that. We struggle being trying to be loved and loving who we want, being who we want to be. And I think we are in a process of accepting that as normal and a part of our society. And gay right movements are facing right now something even more dangerous, which are the groups or political parties that want to deny our existence, more now than ever, because sometimes they have the support of government. And this is the struggle we're facing right now. We thought we had learned a lot, and we had come a long way, and we have achieved a lot, but now everything is in danger. And this, I think this is the current issue that has to worry most us, because it's what everything depends on that.
Mm-hmm. You're totally right, Guillem. Well, we need to conclude here, though, but we're going to complete this chat with the question chain. This is a question for you from our last guest, in this case, the pianist, composer, and improviser, Marco Mezquida. Let's have a look.
Hello, my name is Marco Mezquida. I'm a musician. My question for you, it will be, I have heard that in the few years, we will have in Barcelona and in other cities some flying taxis. I love to be in the taxi, but do you think you will fly in this taxi flying? You will feel comfortable? Yes or not?
I don't think so. I mean, it's something out of a movie, of a Blade Runner movie maybe, but I don't think we're going to see that in the short run.
You know, I heard the most dangerous thing about flying vehicles is not being in the vehicle, it's things falling from the vehicle onto the people below. That's what people are worried about.
That might be right. Well, Guillem, before we go, tell us if Smiley, Després de l'Amor, is going on tour. And when?
Yes, we're starting our winter tour after Christmas. I don't know the dates yet or the places we're going to be, but from January to spring, we will be touring Catalonia. And if you check the internet or my own webpage or...
Exactly.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Then you can see the whole tour there.
Okay, well, Guillem, what can I say? It's been a pleasure, very interesting chat. And, well, if you want to laugh, if you want to have a great time, and if you want to feel emotional and, well, everything you can expect from a great theatre play, we really recommend you Smiley, Després de l'Amor by Guillem Clua. Thank you again, Guillem.
Thank you so much.
And thank you, Barney. Until next time.
Yep, see you next time.
Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine.
And today, the Irish-Catalan singer-songwriter Matthew McDaid is presenting his latest work, Look Away, Sun Child. Don't miss it.
Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we'll leave it. Well, I've been round here, baby, once or twice. Hell, I know the barman, I knew his wife. They've served me courage every night till late. A bottle or six are gonna set me straight, yeah. They're gonna set me straight, yeah. They're gonna set me straight.
This singer and songwriter was born in Northern Ireland but has been living in the small village of Rupit since he was a teenager. And last September, he published his third work, Look Away, Sun Child, which, like his previous albums, has had some impact on the international scene, Matthew McDaid. It's such a pleasure to have you here with us today.
How's it going? Thanks for having me.
It's going well. Actually, welcome back, because you visited us the last time you came here was 2 years ago with Joana Serrat after publishing the album Off the Beaten Track, which sounded great, and now you're here to talk about your third work, an EP called Look Away, Sunchild.
Yep.
Congratulations,
by
the way.
Thanks very much. Thanks.
And tell us what happened in these 2 years.
A lot of things happened. I've wrote new songs. I worked on a farm for a winter. I broke my leg. a lot of things happened. Life.
The pandemic happened.
Did that happen? I can't remember.
Okay, it's better to leave it behind, right? Yeah. This EP, this new EP, has been recorded in Oregon, in the United States, and also in Arizona. How did it go?
It went very well through my management, my label, Great Canyon Records. They put me in contact with a great producer in Oregon called John Morgan Askew. Now, what we did basically was I recorded the guitar and all the guitars and the vocals in Centelles, in Jordi Casa de Sus and Jordi Turre. They have a studio there, and I recorded the basics and then sent it over to John and Corey Gray and Jai Tanser. And they recorded the rest, and we were back and forth talking, and they really captured an essence of Oregon that I really would love to get to know. You know, to be able to go over there and record more with them would be a dream.
Okay, so you're going to have more?
Hopefully, yeah. Well, I've got a couple more that we're talking about recording, and whenever I get the chance, hopefully I'll fly over and okay. Spend some time with them.
So tell us about these three songs. What are they about?
Well, two of them are mine, and one is a Bee Gees cover. So Look Away, Sunchild, the title song of the EP, it's a song about young love and leaving the place that you know best, like the village or something. It's a story about a couple that are leaving a town and looking back and remembering everything good that they have, everything they know, you know, and they're moving on to new horizons, to things that are unknown, that haven't happened yet. And it's that bittersweet feeling. Then the second song, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, is the dance. It sort of symbolizes the dance that we do when we're sort of slowly falling in love. You know, it's a true love song, which I'm not very. I don't normally write love songs, but it sort of came out that way. It's just the dance of the floating, you know, in between two people. And the other one, I Started a Joke, is a classic Bee Gees song that my manager gave me a ring, and he said, can you try this song, but singing it like Kris Kristofferson, which is a real country, is an old country singer, but singing like Kris Kristofferson with a hangover. So luckily I had a huge hangover that day, and I recorded the song on my phone, and somehow it captured the essence of the song, so we put it on the EP as it is,
mm-hmm.
Just a
phone
recording.
Yeah. And where could we find and buy this EP?
You can find it everywhere, all the normal platforms, Spotify, everywhere else,
right.
iTunes. But you can also find it on Bandcamp, which is the other platform where people can go and they can buy the EP, which really helps artists out, and special in these times, you know, it's to actually go out and buy something is important, you know, and not just the 0.0023 cents that Spotify pays for every listen, you know.
Exactly.
You pay a euro, the song is yours, and you get to keep it forever, you know.
That's right. Tell us, to what extent is Rupit, where you live, which is a beautiful, beautiful village, a source of inspiration for your music? And if Rupit is the only, I don't think it is the only source of inspiration, maybe other places such as Menorca. So tell us a little bit about that.
Rupit has always been very, very present. You know, I wake up there every morning, which is a huge privilege. And whenever you wake up there every morning, it does get, you get used to it. You know, which is a strange thing to say, because it is an incredible place to live, but you get used to it, and sometimes you need to leave Rupit to come back, and then the inspiration will flourish when you come back to something. I spend my summers in Menorca, so going to Menorca and finding the different energy, different vibration of the island, and coming back to Rupit in the winter that helps to keep things fresh and keep the inspiration coming. So I'm a country person, 100%. Yeah, I've lived here before, but it's too fast. It's too fast for me. I'm getting old, you know. I need to slow down.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the BBC, because your music, your new album is, you can listen it, it's being played on the BBC quite often, actually, which is great. And also, do you think one of the reasons is because you recorded it with the Great Canyon Records, which you mentioned before, a studio specialized in folk and American music that you worked with before?
I'm sure it definitely has an influence, but yeah, I've been lucky enough that these songs have been on the Ian Anderson's show on BBC Scotland and Lynette Fay's show on BBC Ulster a few times. But I think what happens, obviously, knowing the people that they, you know, they see an Americana label like Great Canyon Records, it obviously, you know, it said, oh, so these people that are with Joanna Serrat, and Joanna Serrat is on Loose, the label in the UK, that they know all these, it's the connections. But apart from that, I think the song went into the system, into the BBC system, and they obviously seem to like it.
To like, know, it, exactly.
Yeah. So yeah, which is a very happy that, that it's being played.
What are you going to perform for us today?
I'm going to play the Look Away Sunchild song, which it's a song that's been good to me for the last few years. So I'm happy to release it.
Okay, looking forward to listening to it, and also looking forward for the new songs that you promised. And I hope you'll be able to come back here and tell us about them.
If you'll have me back, I'll be back, no problem. Yeah, thanks.
Of course, with pleasure. Thank you, Matthew. Until next time.
Cheers.
Surely these holidays you're going to play in a lot of quizzes. So why not start today? Don't miss Guess What with our quizmaster, Sergi Cervera.
Isn't always the way it's supposed to be. Well, nothing lasts the test of time like you and me. So hold on tight, my love. Hold on for dear life. We're gonna make a left turn, honey. We're gonna make it right. So here, take the keys, babe. But don't you drive too fast. Just one chance to leave this place. We better make it last. And how it seems so funny, reaching the edge of town. How all those dreams and memories seem so far from us now. Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we'll leave it. We'll pass the small town baker, cursing the crack of dawn. It means a big mouth talker's welcome rambling on and on. By the late night drinker, we'll finally stumble home. Cursing the worst part of heartbreak is waking up alone. Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we'll leave it. Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we'll leave. Remember all those nights, my love,
sitting out by the door. Now it got so quiet just after 3 o'clock. I'd steal a glance at you, babe, and catch you smiling back. We make plans to leave this place, though we might not be coming back. No, no, no. Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we're leaving. Look away, look away, look away. Look away, look away, sunshine. I think it's time we're leaving.
And now we are getting to, I don't know if the funniest, but certainly the craziest bit of the show.
Hello, 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 and welcome to Guess What? A crazy quiz that jogs the minds of our contestants. Particularly, it makes them think about why they came here in the first place, right?
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Well, let's introduce them first. As our guest contestant today, we've got Marky Smith with us. Hello.
What's that? How
you doing? Nice sweater. Actually, nice sweaters, guys. You have the same stylist, maybe?
Yep.
They don't love you that much, right?
I can't decide which one I like best. Well, Marky is a professional basketball player and also a stand-up comedian who visited our show a few weeks back. So tell us, Marky, what projects do you have in the pipeline?
Right now, I have just launched my own show with Barcelona Comedy Live. And so we have a show actually later on tonight. But other than that, just doing same old, acting, modeling, a little bit of basketball.
Sounds brilliant.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Mark is gonna need something more than his natural charm to beat these two quiz mavericks.
That's right.
Patricia Scalona and Matthew Murtha. Welcome back, guys.
Welcome. You know, I was just doing a bit of acting and modeling and playing basketball, but I was able to make time.
Yeah. You were beating it.
Yeah, right.
Let's see if he has the same luck in the quiz, right?
Okay, let's warm up with the multiple choice challenge. 1 point for each correct answer. And today, we've been inspired by Christmas, a time of peace, which happens to inspire the craziest anecdotes. So, here's the first one.
When I was in London as a waiter working in an hotel, they gave me the chance to work in Christmas Day and sleep there between the 24th and 25th. I was not the only one. So that night we threw a party in the room.
So no better idea before a long Christmas day of work than a party, which ended in one of these three ways. A, in a breakfast, after which they did a runner. B, they were reported to the police by the guests next door. And C, they destroyed the room and had to work all Christmas day for free. Which one is the right one? And remember, I love to hear the logics and the science after your answers.
You go.
You start.
Yeah, you start.
I'm gonna go with C.
You're gonna go with C.
Yeah, because Christmas is the best time to turn up and
to work for free.
Yeah, and I'm just looking at that guy's eyes. That guy looks like he knows how to have a good time.
Okay.
So I'm gonna go with C. I'm gonna say he messed it up and he had to work all Christmas day.
All right, so C for our beloved guest, and what's the scientist thinking?
I'm going the opposite direction. I don't think that guy looks like he knows how to party at all. I think they got to sleep early. They had a good night's sleep. They woke up, they had breakfast, and then got to work. So,
ooh,
A.
I see competition A. here. Someone is jealous of the stand-up comedian.
I'm jealous of this hat that he's getting. Who did props?
How about you, Patricia?
I think it's gonna be B. Somebody called the police on them, right?
Okay, yeah. All right, so.
Okay, so here's how waiters throw a party.
We basically destroyed the hotel room and we worked on the Christmas day, and then at the end of the day they told us that we were not getting any extra money and any money for that day because we were need to pay everything we destroyed into the room.
Well done, man. He knows how to read people. Well, they were going to destroy the, I mean, to have a party, so no big deal anyway.
Maybe he was projecting what
he was projecting.
I think he was probably at the party.
He was at the party.
I think the issue is Matt doesn't know how to party. I think that's where
of course I do.
This comes
you have
down
to get the Pepsi and the carrot sticks. And then the...
We should have had you before, man.
Yeah.
Nice that you are here.
Thank you, man.
Thank you for coming.
Being here.
Okay, so tell us about your wildest party in terms of physical destruction.
Well, remember, we are on television, you know, so...
Good, so then we should start.
Let's keep it polite and easy.
Tell us about, you know, I know you had amazing parties in New York, right?
Back in my day, yes. I used to have amazing parties in New York, yeah.
70s were wild, weren't they?
I really don't remember much. The wildest one I have was a rave in the Bronx.
And
I ended up, you know, stranded because somebody had stolen my purse and everything and my money, so I had to walk back to Manhattan. Ooh. So, yes, that was tough.
Okay.
Matt?
Well,
tell us about these carrot sticks.
We had this amazing, it was me, my mother, and then two of my sisters.
It's too wild for television.
It was crazy, it was crazy. And then somebody dropped the Scrabble game and we couldn't find the tile with the X.
Really?
Hey, when that happens. Well,
I can't hear anymore. This is too tough to hear.
I don't really have anything that wild. One of my craziest parties.
Sure. Sure, man.
Basketball players are known for not partying.
At all. You know, just hard work, you know. And something else, more hard work. I had an amazing party experience here in Barcelona when I first came. It's difficult now because the world's weird, but there's a party that they would do called El Ro. And it was spicy. That's all I got.
We'll leave it here then.
Okay. yes, exactly. Good idea. Okay, so for the following story, we have a Christmas anecdote from one of our best-known witnesses on this quiz, Tony.
In my family, we take Christmas really seriously. So every year we eat dinner in Christmas Eve in my aunt's house with all my family. We always take a big picture of all the family. She takes it really seriously, like it's her photo, it has to be perfect. So a few years ago I was bored and I was like, I want to ruin the picture.
Right. I want to meet this guy, that's what I want to do, I want to meet him.
Yeah. We have to invite him sometime. All right, so here wanted to ruin the family Christmas picture. Okay, why not? But how did Tony do it? Option A, he turned up in a Grinch costume. B, he posed in a torero costume. Ole, ole. Oh, okay. And C, he wore a t-shirt saying, I killed Santa. Which is the right one?
Huh? It got pretty dark there.
Yeah,
it got dark. I think I'm gonna go with B.
With
because
B.
Because this guy is like...
Like...
Yeah,
like
you never know where what he's gonna come up with.
I want to introduce you. I
want to meet him. Yeah.
Okay, we'll make the arrangement. We'll make that match to happen.
Cool breeze. I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to go with her on this one.
Okay.
B. I mean, I think just based on what he was saying, that he's probably from here, and here the family dynamic is very, very big. He's saying it takes it serious. So I think what better way?
What could go wrong, right?
Yeah right? That's the one.
How about the scientist?
What's
on your mind, doctor?
Well, I'm trying to decide between whether it was the Grinch costume or I killed Santa Claus, which is terrifying.
Okay.
And he definitely looks like a serial killer, so I'm going to go with C. I think it's C. Okay.
So let's see in what attire he was finally portrayed.
I went and bought a Grinch costume. I was in the elevator to go to her house. I put my costume like over my clothes and I surprised her with the costume and I didn't take it off for the photo and I ruined it, but it kind of looks good.
There you go, that's our Tony. Point goes to no one, guys.
That was very conservative.
That was very conservative. At the end of the day, he's just a regular Christmas supporter.
It's because killing bulls is not funny.
Yeah, and killing Santa is not funny either.
Not funny either. Yes, of course, he's a human being.
So, guys, right? Do you follow Christmas traditions faithfully, or which Christmas tradition have you broken most?
Everybody thinks that this life that I'm living is crazy, and it is. It's wild. But no, as far as Christmas traditions, my mom, she has this tradition that the night before Christmas, you get to open up a gift. And so we have, my mom does an amazing job. She's got presents stacked above the tree. And we always go to the tree and grab a gift that we want. And she surprises us with gifts that she has pre-wrapped for the night before Christmas. And it's always like a weird, like onesie or like pajama outfit. Yeah, something like this. And that's pretty much it. And then we have breakfast at IHOP.
Okay, okay. Yeah,
sounds good. Funny.
It's cool. IHOP's nice.
I'm not gonna add anything to that.
Any story you wanna share with us?
That's a very cool tradition.
Then let's move forward.
Let's move on to Matthew, right?
Oh, so one Christmas tradition that I like to partake in, even though I'm here in Spain, is just to stare icily cold at any family members that I might not be agreeing with, which is really weird on a Zoom call, but.
We all get used to, this year we all have gotten used to Zoom.
Yeah. Wouldn't it seem like you're staring at all of them weird?
It doesn't work as well as I want it to, because, you know, grandma doesn't know that it's about her, but I do what I can.
Okay, Santa, so let's finish with Natalia, a northerner who got a strange proposition in a strange place.
I'm from Latvia, and my first New Year here, I spent working in Tablao Cordobés with flamenco dancers, and I was like administrator. And one woman called me and asked, what do you have for Noche Buena? I said...
Well, a Latvian clerk walks into a Cordobés tablao, and that's not a joke. That's life. All right, so when asked about Noche Buena, what did she answer? Option A, she said, for me, all the nights are good. B, she said she already had a boyfriend. And C, she was hoping to dance flamenco on the stage. What do you think?
Well, I am a expert in the Castellano language, and I'm pretty sure that...
I thought you were going to say to tablao cordobés.
I have no idea what that means.
Okay.
Be honest, me either.
And I'm pretty sure that it's nacho bueno, which means good nachos, so I'm gonna go with C.
Nacho bueno with C. She was hoping to dance flamenco on the stage.
Yes, because okay. That's what you do when you eat
nachos. Because you're an expert on tablao cordobés. Makes sense. And nachos.
I also believe in buenas nachos. I'm gonna go with B, just because, you know, when you ask a woman if she wants nachos, she thinks, she always thinks it's something more.
I've never
more
thought
than
about it that way, that
yeah,
noche buena could be confused. And
it's pronounced nacho.
Nacho bueno.
How many years have you been here?
There is noche buena, five. Nacho bueno.
The language.
These guys are taking over the show.
I know. Something yeah, as a quiz master, I learn a lot presenting. I mean, this part of.
No, this could go. No, I meant that this could go anywhere from here now. It's like they.
But now you have to deliver an answer, Patricia.
Okay, I'm sorry. So she said that she was having a good night because she got confused with the meaning of the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, anyway, that's what she said.
What do you mean? For me, all the nights are good. I said like, todas las noches son buenas. What do you mean?
All right, there you go. I mean, when you move across Europe to work in a tablao cordobés, all nights are definitely good, for sure. Okay, so let's check the score. Patricia's leading with 1 point, but Marky is leading too with another 1 point and 0 points to Matthew, who has gotten nothing. But yeah. Our love and attention.
Well, okay, next round, the speed challenge. So get ready, and while you do, let's learn 4 Christmas idioms with our teacher, Mark Podrick.
Happy Christmas, everyone! And, of course, you all know lots of Christmas vocabulary. You have sleigh, reindeer, Santa Claus, etc. But how many of you know some Christmas idioms? Well, luckily, I'm here to give you a few. And the first one we have is White Christmas. A white Christmas, of course, is a Christmas full of snow that you look out the window and you can see the beautiful mountains and rolling hills covered in snow. A white Christmas. Now, Christmas comes but once a year. It means literally that Christmas happens once a year, so it's something to look forward to. Now, there are other idioms that we use not just at Christmas time, but throughout the whole year. And one of them is Christmas came early, which means that something happened unexpectedly or you received some good news. And this, of course, doesn't happen exactly at Christmas. It happens during the rest of the year. Then we have with bells on. When you say that somebody is excited about something, you say that they are going around with bells on. So I was queuing up for the concert with bells on. I was giddy with excitement. So I hope that it is a white Christmas for most of you. And remember, Christmas comes but once a year. So be there with bells on and enjoy it. Merry Christmas to all of you.
Yeah, let's do our second round and raise the stakes. 2 points for each right answer. We are close to Christmas, but yesterday, the 18th of December was, hold on, National Ugly Sweater Day, which we see. You guys celebrate still today. I mean, like, you take it very seriously.
Wait,
haven't you?
You're saying my sweater is ugly?
I thought I was talking about. Doesn't matter. It's
I
a bit
spent
ugly.
Much working
it's
on
a bit
this.
Ugly.
I started
it's a bit
in
ugly.
July.
Let's be honest.
It's celebrated on every third Friday of December. The rules are: you have to put on a flashy, gaudy Christmas-themed jumper in the morning, and you're not allowed to take it off until bedtime. No matter if you have a job interview, a wedding, or a funeral to attend. Okay, well, I'm not going to ask you if you are members of this club.
Because you definitely are the owners.
I haven't taken this sweater off for a week.
Yeah, I have a Prime membership.
I could tell when you came.
I wear the Christmas sweaters and the pants that my mom gives us every year, literally all year round. Anytime I want to feel cozy and loved, just put it on.
Actually, yeah, those two are quite okay.
Yeah, it's a
just
real thing.
Saying. Those two, quite okay. Since it's not particularly cold in here, we will leave it out the sweaters and stick with ugly. So in this round, you're going to have to guess ugly fictional characters. We give you a clue and you give us his or her name. Ready? So,
Sergi.
Fictional and real. A real ugly person.
I'm a real boy.
Three, two, one, here we go.
A Jedi who puts words in a funny
Patricia.
Order. Yoda. That's right.
An animated ogre who lives in...
Shrek.
There you go.
A bony woman crazy about the fur of Dalmatians.
Matthew.
Cruella de Vil.
Correct. He showed to Belle his inner beauty. Matthew.
Who is the beast?
Well done.
She's nicknamed Ugly in the title of her TV series.
Betty.
Ugly Betty.
Correct.
That's correct.
Well done. He craves a ring and calls it my precious. Come on. Matthew?
Gollum.
There it is. Gollum.
Okay.
Correct.
A young guy is very attractive until...
Matthew.
Okay, that's true, but it's not
awesome
what
Matt.
I meant. Okay, I start again. A young guy is very attractive until you look at his true self in a portrait.
Patricia.
Dorian Gray.
That's
exactly.
Great. All right. It's a book.
Thanks for saving.
did you answer at the same time,
no.
Both of you? No?
No.
And 2 points goes to her.
Good, yes.
A hideous nanny played by Emma Thompson. What was that?
Remember,
honking the horn?
No, I didn't.
You did it. And any of you? All right, that
right.
was Nanny McPhee.
A slug-like space crime lord in Star Wars.
Who is Jabba the Hutt?
Exactly.
Well done. And last but not least, a girl possessed by a demon. No, she is. Not the right character.
Sorry about that.
Although it could. Huh?
I can see her. I just can't say her name.
Well, say the film.
But describe
the ring.
Yeah.
Not correct. A girl possessed by a demon in a classic horror film. Patricia.
The Exorcist.
That's correct. Okay. The Exorcist.
I can't remember her name. But...
Doesn't matter. I mean,
it was Samantha.
Samantha?
If you say The Exorcist girl, it doesn't. I mean,
okay,
it doesn't work.
Fine.
Yeah.
It's good.
Regan McNeil.
Mm-hmm.
Regan McNeil. Who cares?
McPhee.
Well,
I'll believe you.
Okay. So tell us if you had to invite one of these characters to Christmas dinner. Which one of them would you invite?
Great question.
And you cannot say all of them.
You don't want to invite Shrek or Jabba, right? Because they're going to eat all the food. I want that nanny lady.
Jabba looks fun. Yeah, he knows how to tell stories for sure.
True story.
That's true.
I think you probably invite the big beast.
The beast?
Like, yeah, you like dogs. There's hair all over the place.
The beauty
here.
Anywhere, or the beast?
It'd be maybe great you like feed the beast all table right. scraps.
All right, Marky, you are not going to love this, yeah. but Matthew is on the lead with 10 points. He's Patricia's right behind with 7, and our beloved friend Marky is just holding 3 points, well-deserved, and our love and attention.
But the game is not over.
No, absolutely. So, guys, keep your instruments, because you're going to need them for the next round, the Lyrics Challenge. 3 points for every right answer.
Exactly. And today we are going to recite some verses of very popular Christmas songs. All you have to do is guess the song, use the instrument to be the first to answer. Very easy.
Yeah. Anything goes. The song title, the artist, you can even hum the tune, but you'd better get it right, otherwise we'll take 3 points from you and your competitors will have their chance. I can feel the excitement right
exactly.
now.
Exactly. So, ready to listen to the verses of the first song?
Oh, yeah.
Let's do it.
Okay, so here we go. Just a note. These verses are for everyone, but Matthew knows that I mean you, okay? So I'm thinking about
it. To him.
Exactly. Listen.
Go on.
It's not gonna be easy, but I'll do my best. I gave you my heart. Patricia. And you threw away. That is correct. I wanted to finish. I wanted to finish, but listen up. Music. Someone special. I'll give it to someone special, not me, just the lyrics, okay?
I think you're an octave lower. That's what was causing the confusion.
You can sing along if you want.
I got you.
Of course, so this song was...
it was, of course, Last Christmas by Wham. Mm-hmm.
Released in 1984, it's become a classic, but you might not know that George Michael donated all of the royalties of the song to the Ethiopian famine relief.
Okay, so next song.
Oh, the weather outside is
Matthew.
Frightful.
Sing.
And the day is so delightful. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
Okay. Well, music, please.
Okay. Oh, the weather outside is frightful. But the fire is so delightful. Since we've no place to go.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Exactly, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. A classic during Christmas time popularized across the world by the voice of Frank Sinatra, of course. Although the lyrics don't mention anything about Christmas.
Not at all.
Crazy, right?
Yeah. That's how good he was. You knew what he was talking about.
Yeah.
He didn't need to mention it.
Okay, and it's time for the next song, Sergi.
Absolutely. So get ready for a creepy one. Listen up. He sees you.
He sees you when you're sleeping.
Keep singing.
He knows when you're awake.
Go.
He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. I don't know the rest of it.
No, I'll keep going. That was, great music. Music. It was amazing.
He sees you when you're sleeping. There it is. He knows when you're awake.
He knows if you've been bad
or good, so be good for goodness sake.
Yes, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, in this case, sung by Ella Fitzgerald, but it's being sung by hundreds of artists.
Mm-hmm. Hundreds of artists, including Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm.
Including Michael Jackson, yeah.
Okay, and this song was first recorded in 1934. Sheesh. It was an instant hit, of course, with more than 30,000 records sold within 24 hours, and that at the height of the Great Depression.
Wow. I see the competition here between you two, and we're going to push through that direction. So, for another Christmas song, shall we take it away?
So, for weak and for the strong, for rich and the poor ones, the world is so wrong.
Wow. Think about it. Matthew.
For rich and the poor, for sitting in the door.
Nice try. Hey. 3 points, but you did it with, I was going to say dignity, but I'm prepared.
Don't do anything. Okay,
let's listen to it.
Exactly, let's listen up.
For weak and for strong.
Ooh.
For rich and the poor ones.
I just said we loved seeing you losing 3 points, but you did it. You did it in a funny way.
All right.
Not with dignity.
I make losing points look good.
It's yeah, true. Okay, yeah, yeah. I mean, this sweater, losing
everything,
3 points,
everything
it's all right. It's
losing
Christmas.
Look good. Like...
Yeah, of course, that was well, John Lennon with Happy Christmas, War is Over. It is the culmination of John Lennon and Yoko Ono's campaign against the Vietnam War, a Christmas okay. classic, for sure.
Classic. Vietnam War, a Christmas classic.
Christmas classic. We don't like war.
All right.
No, not
and
at all.
Now it's time for the last song. Pay attention because this time, okay, this song might decide the winner.
Yes. So let's just make a second of full silence. John, okay, just wanted to feel the excitement because someone is gonna lose.
Don't look at me.
No, I wasn't looking at you. It was just natural.
I was looking
charm.
In my direction.
just and kind of somebody over there. Is going to win. Let's see who that person is. I don't. Patricia.
No. All I want for Christmas is you.
Listen up! That was incredible, right?
Two words?
Just two words!
There is no
she's the unbeatable Patricia! More. Sing it, sing it, sing it! Sing along!
Yeah, sing that.
Come on!
She didn't even know those words. She just was like, I don't!
That's what I did on the last one and I
Christmas.
Lost 3 points.
Yeah,
I think
but
it's
you,
this
you
one.
Were out of tune. Let's be honest. You want to keep singing?
There is nothing I need, oh I don't
where
want.
Oh,
well,
don't.
That's enough.
Yeah,
thank
whatever.
You.
Yeah,
music,
okay.
please.
Okay. Is that Cher again? Oh, this is right.
Ooh, we're just having fun here.
Right.
Yeah, we couldn't go without the smashing biggest Christmas hit. All I want for Christmas is you, Patricia. Well done by Mariah Carey. Oh, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. That's, what's going on here? No, 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 no. You
sorry,
have our attention.
Sorry, what was the song again?
Two very interesting points to have our attention. You can hug again if you want. Now you have our
no, the second time it's weird.
All right.
Okay, so this was All I Want for Christmas Is You by Mariah Carey. By Mariah Carey, one of the best-selling singles of all time. It has sold 16 million copies and earned over 60 million in royalties since its release in 1994. Wow.
Well, after all this fun, we have concluded today's game. And the score looks like this. Patricia won the Christmas contest with 13 points. Matthew got 10 and Marky got six.
But
that's a six,
well
not a zero.
It's a six.
So well played, Marky. I hope you had fun with us.
I did. I had an amazing time. I got destroyed, but it was a good cast to get
you can come back if you want.
Yes, please, please have me back. And when I come back,
we want
gold.
You back. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, thank you again, Marky, Matthew, Patricia. It was great to have you with us today. And of course, thank you, Sergi.
Yay!
Merry Christmas to all of you. Happy holidays. And until next time, until next year. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays
bye,
to
everybody.
You too.
Hi, bye-bye.
And so we've reached the end of last show for this year. The Weekly Mag will return in January. Until then, you can keep up your English with all our online videos and you can follow us on social media. And you can also try to crack our special guess words by Mario Serra. 4 different words that will help you guess 4 different very famous Christmas carols. You know, you can follow us online to find out the solution. Until then, thank you so much for watching. Have a great Christmas and a very happy new year. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.
You better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list and checking it twice. Gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town.
He's watching.
He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness. forsake. Oh, you better watch out. You better not cry. Better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town.